As I'm sure you're well aware, fire is the number one risk to nuclear plants, nuclear reactors. Here at Indian Point, this is our third transformer fire since 2007. In 2009, the NRC said there was 198 of the 275 fire zones lacked automatic fire protection, suppression. I want to know, how has that been repaired? Are we covered for fire protection? Our community is at risk. We're nervous when we see this. When we see a fire, when we hear the sirens going off, we don't have any confidence that Entergy can run this plant safely. The Entergy, and I'm asking you a question, do we need an act of Congress to make the NRC uphold the Atomic Energy Act? It took an act of Congress to get us sirens. We didn't even have sirens until Congress demanded it. And then it took 4 years for Entergy to do it because of the briny atmosphere here. Now we have transformers that are blowing up, and you don't know why. Entergy says, we don't know why. We don't know how to fix it. How can we trust they can run a nuclear plant when they can't manage transformers and sirens? So do we need an act of Congress to make you do your job? Secondly, I would like to ask you to give us an accounting. I'd like an audit of how much money the NRC spent to fight New York State's request to have, and the ASLB's request, to not include aging transformer management in the relicensing proceeding. I'd also like to know how much money you spent fighting and litigating against us, our request and our demand that you fix the defective fire route at Indian Point, so that we don't have 24 minutes between us and a meltdown. How much money have you spent on that when it would cost $500,000 to fix? We're sick and tired since 2007 that's been going on. You don't care about the public safety. And with regard to this question of with two other issues on monitoring, I read the 2012 monitoring report, and I read this report, the recent report now. And there's defective monitoring going on. In 2012, for many months, there was no monitoring at all. This year, it seems there's still that problem. When are you going to fix the monitoring? And we want it publicly available 24/7, real-time point source monitoring. And we also want to know how much CO2 and radioactive CO2 and methane is being released from the plant every day. It's a fallacy that nuclear is carbon-free. It produces carbon. It makes new carbon that never existed on the planet. Every single day, it operates and all through the days of spent fuel. And last year, I asked a question. I'm still waiting for an answer. I FOIA'd it, and I haven't gotten the answer. They're playing games with me. How much high burnout fuel is there in the pools at Indian Point? We need to know that. We are right to know that. As much security as for survivors can know that. That's the answer tonight. I'm sure you know it. I'm sure one of the Entergy people here know it. And I really request, once again, that Entergy is here to answer our questions. The other question is, how many contracts have there been since Entergy took ownership of this plant? Every time there's a hot shutdown, there's a greater increase of radiation exposure. Women and children are much more susceptible to radiation than women 2 times, children 7 times. We have a right to know how much.
Tom Abinanti. I am the New York State Assemblyman. I represent this area. Thank you for coming back to Westchester again. You're in the center of my district, so welcome. I appreciate you coming to hear what people have to say. I've appeared here before. My message has always been the same. I have very serious concerns about continuing the operation of the Indian Point nuclear power plants. I spent 19 years as a Westchester County legislator representing this area. Now I'm in my fifth year as a New York State Assemblyman. And I think most of what needs to be said is being said by the people who live in this area and are very seriously concerned about their safety and the safety of our neighborhoods. You will recall that the Westchester County Legislature repeatedly has expressed concerns which have not been addressed. There were statements that there's no way to evacuate. That's obvious. I mean, you just go outside right now, you can't get out of the parking lot here. And you're not going to get people anywhere, so sheltering in place is the only possibility. and that basically is not any a real plan. The New York State Assembly has passed a resolution expressing concerns about continuation of the Indian Point power plant. We've had the governor has been stated the governor's concerns, the DEC is concerned, just about everyone is concerned, everyone who's responsible for ensuring the safety of the people who live in this area. I mean, even as it was pointed out, you can't even get the insurance companies to insure the plant. We're talking here about 1.7 million people who, 1.7 million people who live in near proximity to the plant, not to mention the 8 million people who are in New York City downwind, but just in this area, when you look at and it's growing. You never would put this plant here. I can't understand why anybody's seriously considering renewing the license. It's an old car that we've kept going. Somewhere along the way, the car breaks down. And, so somewhere along the way, we have to end this plant. We've been fortunate. There haven't been any really serious incidents, but we're getting more and more incidents. How much longer can we keep this plant going? I'm very concerned about that. Somewhere along the way, you've got to say, let's just close it down. And I think it's that point. We all understand that it was built, 40 years ago, with technology that's probably 60 years old. We're not talking about new technology. We're not talking about a new plant. I come back every year, and every year I come back, there has been another incident. Again, we've been fortunate that none of these incidents have been very serious. But if they were serious, what do? All of these people can't move, they can't go, and they're going to just write off billions and billions of dollars worth of real estate. They're going to write off billions and billions of dollars of everything else that's in those real estate. I mean, we like to think we're in the center of the world. We don't want to see the center of the world just go, just because we decided we're going to try to stretch this place a little bit longer. So I ask you to please hear what people have to say. It really is time to say thank you for your service. We're fortunate, but now let's just move on and do something else with the site. So thank you for listening.
Japan, Naoto Kan, who was Prime Minister during the Fukushima crisis. And he came and spoke to us in New York City twice. This is the first time he spoke. And he was describing at the point in the Fukushima reactor accident when he brought his experts around him and asked them, what's the worst case scenario? To quote, and do remember that Fukushima was 150 miles from Tokyo. 50 million people, almost half the entire nation of Japan, abandon homes, leave workplace, schools, hospitals, all evacuated. I realized Japan would not be able to function as a nation for a very long period of time. They couldn't minimize spread before a situation so grave. Now, bear in mind that 80% of the radiation from Fukushima blew out to sea, to the Pacific Ocean. Indian Point is not near the sea. An accident at Indian Point would devastate the New York metropolitan region. And here, gentlemen and any ladies who might be with the NRC today, is my question to you, because I believe you are misleading the people of New York and the American public. When you state that you have determined there is safety and reasonable assurance, because reasonable assurance means different things to you than it would mean to any normal member of the public. You say that the risk of a major accident is low risk. What you call high consequence events are low risk so that they can be discounted. And yet, When you go and talk to your public, I've never once heard any member of the NRC emphasize the fact that the nuclear industry will not self-insure, that under the Price-Anderson Act of 1957, half a century ago, before nuclear power was supposed to be proven so safe, that neither the insurance industry, the independent arbiter of risk, nor the nuclear industry, which knows the reality of its own safety, will insure for risk. And that is based on the public. And I think that is a pretty relevant fact. And you should bring it up, I think, every time you give a reasonable assurance of safety.
Thank you very much.
I'm with New York City Friends of Clearwater and United for Action, and listening to everything here tonight, I'm just being overwhelmed by a feeling of tragedy. I see that the people from NRC are working very hard, and I'm sure the folks from Entergy are working very hard also to try to, you know, maintain safety standards, improve safety standards, you know, put band-aids on this aging plant, and we're being given reassurances that the plant is operating safely. But the plant is not operating safely even when there is no accident at all, because even under normal operating conditions, there is radiation spewing into the atmosphere, and people who live near the plant are getting more cancer than people in other areas. So how can we say that we have a safe operating plant? How can we say that we're taking an acceptable risk that there may not be a catastrophic accident, okay? All right, even if there's only a 5% risk, and you know, I'm not going to go in numbers, but what I'm saying is this would be a tragedy of such magnitude, as other people have already said, okay? This is New York City we're talking about. This is the financial center. This is the cultural center. This is the nerve center. We can't risk this for nuclear power, which is totally unnecessary. We're being told that if we don't have nuclear power, we're going to have asthma. That is totally not true, because renewables are here and they're ready. Solar power, wind power, small-scale hydroelectric are ready, and we don't need the nuclear power. Now, I know people are concerned about jobs, and I share that concern about jobs, and I know people, you know, people have said, like, well, the folks who live in Buchanan, they're fine folks, and I'm sure they are. But what is the point of jobs if your children get sick, if your whole town is destroyed by radiation, if our whole way of life is destroyed by the way we're doing things, okay? We have to wake up. We just have to wake up. I know we're all trying to do the best that we can with the technology, but we have to wake up to the consequences. There's no two ways about it. I'm not going to repeat all the things that you've already heard about why this is so dangerous. We just have to wake up and realize that we don't need nuclear power and we should go to renewables. We need to close this plant and we need to do it now.